right, we're in our study on Ephesians 4, and we're moving through, and we're verse 20 and 21. It says, "That, however, is not the way of life you learned when you heard about Christ and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that's in Jesus." Now, taking that out of context without knowing what that's about, a little hard to understand what's going on. So we need to remind you that we've been learning what our condition was before we were saved. And these statements, very interesting that they align a lot with what Frank was telling us about the Freedom From Religion Association. They say, well, their Christianity calls non-Christians second-class citizens. No, we don't. God does. Now, these terms that we're looking at are not complementary. Matter of fact, there's a sense in which some of us who are Christians in care could squirm a little bit when we look about these terms that the Bible uses that are true of every one of us before Christ entered our lives. Listen to what they are. It says the person without Christ is futile in their thinking. And we've looked at some length about what that means. The next phrase kind of helps define that a little bit. They're darkened in their understanding. They cannot comprehend the things of God. And that's always so stunning for me when I do funerals. I unapologetically give a very strong presentation of the gospel. I've had some people express different angst about that, and I really don't care. It's the only time many people will ever get to see the gospel. And I think to water it down is ridiculous. Now, I'm not here to be a hellfire and brimstone kind of guy, but I want to talk very clearly about what the Bible has to say about eternity. But you cannot understand that if God doesn't do it. I look out over congregation after congregation when I do funerals and talking about our need for Christ and the wonderful gift he's given. And it's like talking to a host. There's just no awareness, interest at all. God has to do something. Because, he says, not only are they futile in their thinking, darkened in their understanding, they're separated from the very life of God. And then this is really insulting. They're ignorant. Now, who here really enjoys being called ignorant? That's not a fun thing to tell someone. And when we studied this passage a few weeks ago, we talked about what they're ignorant of. He said their hearts are hardened and their sensitivity is given over to sensuality. In other words, they aren't sensitive to the things of God. They're only sensitive to the things of the sensual. Now, that's the characteristic that God uses to describe the non-Christian mind. There's two reasons why I've been anxious for us to understand this. Number one is to realize what God has saved us from. Every one of us came from that position. And secondly, to help you understand, those that you're trying to introduce to Christ, what you're dealing with. So we're in the midst of trying to learn what God's intention was in saving us. And we're suggesting to you that the reason he's chosen you is he wants to astonish the world. I wonder, do too many people say of you, boy, that Dorothy Johnson, she is astonishing. Now, Ruthie and I would be among a group who would say that, because we think Dorothy is astonishing. And she knows that because we have this sweet fellowship. But God wants people to say that about every one of us because they see this radical change from what we were to what we are now. So the question is, this new creation work, as I'm trying to call it, that God is doing in our lives, is it evident? Is there something unique and special and different about you that shows you that God has really done something? And the phrase that he uses to describe this work is this phrase, "That is not the way of life you learned." Now, are you ever amazed at how people think? I don't want to get too political about it, but the point is can really be well made. The demonstrators against President Trump these days. There's a couple of different people that go out and they do interviews and they ask them questions about why are you demonstrating? Most of them have no clue. Or the answers they give are absolutely ignorant. And see, the problem for most of us is that we really don't realize we're a product of what we've learned or not learned. And so Scripture tells us that as a Christian, we've learned something different. And what we want to think about this morning is, how do we learn? What have we learned? What does that result in? So the contrast between the Christian and non-Christian is absolutely profound, and it's measurable. It's measurable. When a person becomes the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit, you cannot live like you did before. Because the Holy Spirit is the very power of God. The life of the Christian is altogether different, and the text uses the word Gentiles. And for those of you who might be a little newer to the New Testament, the word Gentiles was used of those who were not Christians, not of the family of God. So there's a lot of studies in our day that tell us the Christians aren't that much different from the average person in our culture. And many of those studies that have been done, as I've been watching when I was a kid till now, are continually showing less and less difference all the time. It's not just that our behavior must be different. Our behavior results from a new mind that God has given us in Christ. It's not just what you do, it's how you think that makes you particularly different. When I was growing up, I remember in my youth days that I used to hear my youth pastors say all the time that the Christian thinks about different things than the non-Christian does. And I've always said, no, that's not true. And some of you are shaking your head, so you got to hear this. I need to slow down to make sure you get that. That's not true. What makes a Christian different is not what he thinks about, it's how he thinks about everything. Let me say this again. This is one of those places where your learning needs to be heightened just a little bit. It isn't what we think about. It's how we think about everything. You get that? All right, so give it back to me. I want to make sure you get this. It's how we think about everything. So you see, there is no secular and sacred in the life of the Christian. Everything is sacred. We think about everything, but we think about it from God's point of view. You get that? All right. It's not just words, though. This is a real concept. So 2 Corinthians 10, 3-5 says, "For though we live in the world, we don't wage war." Let me stop there just a minute. Interesting language, isn't it? Now, in most of your days when you were growing up in the church, we sang the song, "Onward, Christian Soldier." We can't say that anymore. Certainly can, because that's what we are. You see, we are at war. But who are we at war with? The Muslims? No. With the certain political party that you don't like? No. We're at war with Satan and his kingdom, and we'll see this more in just a minute. So we wage war, but we don't do it as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, our weapons have divine power to demolish strongholds. Now, since I'm a history major, and a lot of the study I did in history was World War II, and I did a lot of study of Nazi Germany, and the church particularly in Nazi Germany, and someday I need to tell you more about that. I have taught on that around here. It's fascinating study. But one of the things that always impressed me is the strongholds that Hitler built. And if you've ever seen any of the PBS programs that show you some of this, they were absolutely remarkable. You know why Hitler didn't win? Only because God didn't want him to. There is no reason whatsoever why Nazi Germany shouldn't be ruling the world today. It wasn't America's success. It was God's plan. Now, we had a huge part in that, please understand. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive a few thoughts to make them right. Oh, you guys are so picky about this stuff. Every thought to make it obedient to Christ. You see, it's not what you think about, it's how you think about everything. You get that? All right, every thought captive to make it obedient to Christ. Now, over the next number of weeks, we're going to be looking at what that looks like, and we're getting real practical, but we're still moving up to that. So in the general sense, as a new creation Christian, we don't conform to the pattern of this world, but we're transformed by the renewing of our minds. And this is a mental thing. It's not an emotional thing. And then we'll be able to attest and approve what God's will is. And here's your absolute profound test. The good, pleasing, and perfect will of God. The Christian mind sees what God wants as good, pleasing, and perfect. It was amazing to me that really pretty much the whole church is aware of what Ruthie and I have been involved in for the last 4 months or so now with Ruthie's double surgery and double cancer threat. And you, if you're in church, you'll see a video with us in it thanking the church for what you've done. And we have been absolutely humbled by your love for us. But you see, for us, it's never been about healing. Never. Because you see, in one sense, now put your head on straight, because this one's going to blow you out of the water. Physical healing is second best. You know what's first best? Going to heaven. I mean, this is so obvious to me, and yet it's amazing to me how we miss it as a group. I hear all the time people say, well, how are you? And you say, well, I'm pretty good considering the alternative. And I want to say, I'm terrible considering the alternative. I'd much rather be with the Lord. Wouldn't you? Yes. But our language betrays our heart in this matter. Paul says, I would rather be with the Lord. But as long as God wants me here and has a plan for me here, I'm delighted to be where he wants me to be. Do you understand that thinking? So Ruthie and I were not scrambling for the latest possible solution to cancer. Now, God was gracious this time. This has been the third and fourth times of cancer for Ruthie. The first was melanoma, the second was breast, the third one was colon cancer, and it was there, but they got it all. And then we had this other mass that we thought was cancerous, and the doctor said, just about, headed right there, but we were able to get it out before it became cancerous. But at not any point were we scrambling for God to heal us. At no point was my focus as her husband that God would heal her. My focus was on God, we want your good, pleasing, and perfect will to be done. And see, friends, if you really understand that, you're not living in this horrible pit where you're just devastated that cancer hit you or financial problems hit you or whatever else is going on, because your only goal is the good, pleasing, and perfect will of God. And see, I have huge problems with people who says it is never God's will that you would be sick. It doesn't say that anywhere in Scripture. Matter of fact, interesting, do you remember the story of the blind man and Jesus healed him? And the people came to him and said, well, who sinned? Did the blind man or his parents? Because in that day, much like in our own day, people thought that illness was God's judgment. And Jesus said, neither. He was blind for the glory of God. And in that case, God healed him of his blindness. But you know what? The blind man died. Every person who's ever healed is healed temporarily because every one of us will die. There's only one permanent healing. And you know what that is? Resurrection. So So do you understand what I'm saying here about the good, pleasing, and perfect will of God? Now the real test of it then is as God plays that out in our lives individually, can we say good, pleasing, and perfect? Sometimes God sends the Babylonians. It's Habakkuk. Sometimes God sends the cancer. Sometimes God's healing is slow, and Ruthie and I are feeling that very much. Real slow progress with some setbacks here and there. All right. There are many things that are profoundly different in a Christian. Becoming a Christian isn't joining a club, being religious, having a high moral standard, being a Republican, or anything else you want to put in the blank. It's being totally recreated by the sovereign Lord of the universe. And it shows itself in the way you think about everything. It begins by our understanding of salvation. It is completely and only through the work of Christ. Now, it's amazing to me again. Funerals just, I have such mixed feelings about them. I always welcome doing them, but I always come away with just this horrible sense of dread because I know people heard the gospel and have rejected it. And I know it doesn't depend on me because, you see, I could go anywhere I want. I could be the greatest evangelist ever there. But if you're talking to a dead person, what are they going to stay? Dead. So God has to bring them to spiritual life. So the first thing that God helps us to understand is the nature of our salvation. And we're in utter and complete awe at it. Sadly, for many of us, we thought that becoming a Christian is just being a really nice person and adding church to it. It's not. It's recognizing that you are a horrible, sinful person who God has redeemed and declared righteous. John 14:6. I am the way, the truth, and the life. The only way people can come to the Father is through their own ideas. No, he says, no one comes to the Father but by me. Narrow? Yep. Who said it? Jesus. Now, if you don't want to believe that, that's fine. Get your hell underpants on. Because that's where you're going to go. All right, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. Now, that's either true or it isn't true. I'm always kind of amused at people. I had a great experience of this with a nurse one day when I was talking to my back doctor. And she said, oh, yeah, I went to Rolling Hills once. I went to a funeral there. And the preacher gave a very strong sermon on salvation. And I know it was me. She didn't know it was me. And she said, I felt like they were jamming something down my throat. Well, you see, the gospel doesn't jam anything down anybody's throat. You can gamble and say, I'm going to reject it if you want. And that's the only place I would say, I don't care. Because it's your choice. Now, in a sense, I do care, because if that's your choice and you don't change it, you're destined for eternal hell, and nothing concerns me more than that. But it's your choice, you see. All right, so number one, we understand and fully embrace the facts of our salvation. And that includes born of a Virgin Mary. Amazing to me in the church how prominently that has been attacked for long as I've been alive, more and more now than ever. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried, rose the third day, ascended into heaven, is at the right hand of God interceding for us, and will return to earth and reign eternally as King of kings and Lord of lords. You know what that is? That's one of the creeds. Part of the Apostles' Creed, there's another one very much like it called the Nicene Creed, Statements of Faith. But number two, we understand and submit to the purpose of our salvation. Not only the means by which it came, but the purpose of it. Why did God save you? So you wouldn't go to hell? No. First chapter of Ephesians 3:6, praise be to God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world. What's his purpose? that we would be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us for adoption as sons and daughters through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will to the praise of his glorious grace. Why did God save you? Because he wants to bring praise to himself through you. He wants people to look at you and say, wow, what a different person. Number three, we understand that we live differently because we've been taught in him with accordance of the truth that's in Jesus. And in a couple of weeks, we're going to see this really critical, this key role of truth. Now, this is going to be really strong. So bear with me here. Do you know what at the core a non-Christian's life is built on? The deception of Satan. Now, they don't know any better, because Satan blinds them. But at the core of what a non-Christian is, the deception of Satan is what's writing the agenda, the lies, the pretension that he sets up against the knowledge of God. That's what's so sad. It started in the Garden of Eden. You remember what Satan said? God doesn't want what's best for you. Now, one of the things when I talk to the high schoolers on Wednesday, I want to talk about this. The world is going to say you should have sex anytime you want it, take drugs, do this, do that, and all of it will be based on Satan's law. And it will ruin their lives from start to end. God doesn't want what's best for you, so ignore him. Matter of fact, Satan says you can do a better job of running your life than God can. Now, I must tell you, that's not limited to high schoolers. We wrestle with the same question every day. Thirdly, there will be no consequences for disobeying God. Those were his three main lies. And they're the same lies he uses today. And then he adds the fourth one, that my way is better than God's way, and I will convince you that I am acting freely to choose it, although it puts me in bondage. And so we hear this phrase all the time misused, well, that's my free will. Friends, please understand, you do not have any free will. Outside of Christ, you only have the free will to choose the next sin. I hear this so often, misunderstood. The non-Christian only has the free will to choose to sin. They don't have the free will to choose not to sin because Satan has them in bondage. The only person who has a truly free will is the person who God has recreated. So 2 Thessalonians 2:9-12 says, the coming of the lawless one will be in accordance with how Satan works. So how does he work? He will use all sorts of power through signs and wonders that serve his lie, and all the ways that wickedness deceive those who are perishing. They perish because they refuse to love the truth and so be saved. For this reason, God sends them a powerful delusion, so they will believe the lie, and will all be condemned who have not believed the truth, but have delighted in wickedness. Now, we can give lots of examples to that. We'll see more of them in weeks to come. But what brings about the change in us that breaks us out of this bondage to Satan's lie? It's God's recreative work where he makes us new in the attitude of our mind. You see, Christianity is reasonable and testable. It's not emotion, it's thinking. We were futile in our thinking and darkened under our understanding because we've been given the mind of Christ. Everything has changed. We've been taught in accordance with the truth that's in Jesus. We're not like we were. So You see this supremely even in the Lord's Prayer. Remember how it starts? Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be my name. What? No, come on, come on, come on. You got to think well of yourself. Got to have self-esteem. Come on. Hallowed be my name. Hallowed be my name. Now, I will tell you, friends, that unless you have a new creation mind, you will never say, hallowed be thy name. It will always be, hallowed be my name. And you look at the majority of people who have really authentically, aggressively rejected Christ, where does it hinge? On this point. Because they'll say, I prayed that God would heal my mother, and he didn't, therefore I rejected him. Or I prayed that God would give me a baby, and he didn't, and I rejected him. You fill in the blank. It's hallowed be my name. And every human being will pray that. The only one who prays hallowed be thy name is the person with a new mind. What do they say next? Thy will be done. Jesus said to the people of his day, Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you hypocrites. As it is written, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. A Christian has a desire to want to do what God wants. The work of God does not save up when he does this. It starts with giving us this new heart, so that we can understand and respond to the offer of the gospel. And we know that we have this new heart when we love, desire, and treasure him. We're able to hear Christ, able to want to be taught about him. So Jesus says in John 5:24, very truly I tell you, whoever hears my words and believes in him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged, but is crossed over from death to life. And this is the major difference between the Christian and the non-Christian. We hear his word and we believe it. It's not just listening, it's really hearing. A great example of that's Lydia. I don't suspect too many of you had a lot of study with Lydia. She's worth it. Sometime we should look at her at length. She was the seller of purple in Thyatira. And this is what is said of her, whose hearts the Lord opened. She attended unto the things that were spoken to her by Paul. Unless God opens your heart, you will never hear. And then he talks about seeing. And there's a huge difference between seeing and perceiving. A person can look at a flower and see the evidence of a remarkably creative God, or see just another flower. Or the botanist will just see the anatomy of the flower. Science gets too much credit. Am I anti-science? No. But I'm theologian first, scientist second. I don't need science to prove what the Bible says. When science does its best work, you know what it does? It proves what God said. Romans 1:20-21, for since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse. For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him, but their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were dark. Let me just use one example. God says, you shall not use the name of the Lord your God in vain. You know what our culture does? It means nothing to them to use God's name in vain. And that isn't just saying, God, damn it. Now, that wouldn't be a bad phrase if you were talking about Satan, to say, God, would you please damn Satan? That's what you're asking when you say, God, damn it. But there's lots of other ways we use the Lord's name in vain. We use it in just casual language instead of honoring his name. And God says, if I have a new mind, we're going to see this in detail in a few weeks, I'm going to honor his name. I'm going to be careful how and where I use his name. To hear Christ means that what he says and what is said about him takes us captive. You understand it, you treasure it, you apply it. I'll give you a personal example, and I shared this with you a couple of weeks ago, but it's very fresh for me, so I'll say it again. The Bible tells me that God is absolutely sovereign. There is nothing that happens in my life that he's not in charge of. So I'm sitting with Ruthie in a blood draw place. Many of you already know the story because I've told it so many times. But I'm going to tell it a lot because it really impacted me. And we got there and the doctor had made an electronic reservation. And we got to the desk and the desk says, oh, we have no record of this. And Ruthie cried. We were kind of, well, the way I've been describing it, our straw that broke the camel's back file was full. Just, we were going through so much, didn't take very much to do it. So when Ruthie cries, John is not happy. I was really upset. So we drove down to the doctor's office. Fortunately, I didn't make a fool of myself, but I was very forceful. And I said, you've got a very angry patient here. Please treat me carefully. I need an order for Ruthie's blood draw, and I want it right now. They were quick to do it. They know us very well at this doctor's office. We're loved there. They love us. We love them. All right, so we went back to the blood draw thing. I was sitting there waiting for Ruthie, and I was waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting. And Ruthie's one of these where they never find the vein. It's pokey, 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 pokey. When she had her breast cancer, I was sitting there waiting for this, and I said to the nurse, stop! You go get somebody who knows how to do this right now. You can tell I love Ruthie, right? So anyway, she's sitting in the back there, time going by, and I'm thinking, pokey, 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 and I'm thinking, it's not going to be a happy scene if John goes back there. By God's grace, just then, Ruthie walks out. I said, are you okay? Yep. Got to the car and she says, guess what happened? The nurse that took my blood, husband left her a couple days ago at Christmas. Ruthie had profound opportunity to minister to that lady. You see, the thing I had forgotten in the early part of that story is the sovereign God was in charge. And he had to mess up our plans because the timing wasn't right. Ruthie needed to be in that chair with that woman at that moment. And the only way he could do that was to mess up our plan. And what did John do? John got all upset. Stupid John. You talk about ignorance. After it was all over, I said, wow, God, when am I ever going to learn this lesson? If God is the sovereign God, he is the one who's going to orchestrate every minute and every detail of our lives, and we can have joy in it. Now, it's not that I shouldn't have been upset with the system that wasn't working right, and when I see the doctor next time, I'm going to talk to him about the system. That's all proper, but you see, I lost my joy in the midst of it, and there was no reason for that. It was because I was not letting God's new creation work live in me. Do you see that? And may I suggest to you that most of us miss it because we don't hear what Christ means when he says what he says. And he says, let my word take you captive, treasure it, apply it. All right, when a person hears Christ, he becomes the chief thing in his life and it governs and controls everything. And it gets immensely practical. And it is a hearing that is continual and effective. And if I'd have been doing that day in the blood draw floor, I would not have been upset. I was absolutely no help to Ruthie at the moment. She was an emotional basket case, and I just poured more coals on it. It wasn't until it was all over that we both just said, wow, God. Ephesians 4:21, when you heard about Christ and were taught in him with accordance to the truth that's in Jesus, that's what's making the difference. So what does it mean to be taught in him? It's not that we're being given inside information, it's that the information is being put inside of us. Christ is coming to live in us in such a way that everything that Christ is now lives in you. I love 1 Corinthians 2, 8-16. It says, none of the rulers of this age understood it, the things of Christ. For if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. However, it is written, what no eye has seen and no ear has heard, what no human mind has conceived, the things that God has prepared for those who love him, these are the things that God has revealed to us by his Spirit. Now there are people, even our rooted book says this wrongly, can't know the purposes and mind of Christ. Yes, you can. That's the whole recreation work. God has literally placed his mind in the Christian. We can know the things of God. We can understand them. We can put them into practice. So what we have received, the text goes on to say, is the Spirit that is from God, so that we may understand what God has really given us. And this is what we speak, not in words taught by human wisdom, but in words taught by the Spirit, explaining spiritual realities with Spirit-taught words. And I love this phrase. He says, we have the mind of Christ. Do you understand, friends? This new creation work means that you think with the mind of Christ about everything. Ephesians 1:17 says, I keep asking the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, that he might give you the spirit of wisdom and understanding, so that you might know him better. And I pray the eyes of your heart might be enlightened in order that you might know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and the incomparably great power for us who believe. Now, we looked at that in those details weeks and weeks and weeks ago now. I hope you know what those are. Philippians puts it a different way. He says, but whatever was of my gain, Paul says, I now consider a loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I've lost all things. I consider them garbage, that I might gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness that comes from the law, but that which is through Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. And the two funerals, one I led on Thursday, the one I visited on Friday, both of them had a DVD. And as you see the pictures, both of these were ladies who died. These little girls growing up and all the different events of their lives. And I sit there and I say, oh, I see the hand of God. I see the hand of God. You know the thing that always troubles me about the families? They miss that whole point. God says he's orchestrating our life from beginning to end. And the person who has the mind of Christ sees it and rejoices in it. The life of Christ is in us as Christians. It's not an external list of do's and don'ts. Since then you've been raised with Christ, Colossians says, set your hearts on things above where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds and affections on things above, not on earthly things, for your died and your life is now hid with Christ in God. The summary of it is this, to see the profound transformation that's taken place in the life if you're a Christian. The futile thinking has given way to having the mind of Christ. The darkened in the understanding becomes the Spirit of God giving us the understanding of the things of God. Being separated from God becomes, we are the very dwelling place of God. The ignorance that is in them means we're taught by the Holy Spirit and his word. The hardened heart is replaced by a new heart. And the given over to sensuality now becomes a new desire for God. Therefore, you can't possibly go on living like a non-Christian, because we've heard of and been taught in Christ. He bore our sins on the cross. He suffered the penalty for my guilt. He delivered me from the bondage of sin and Satan, and he took up residence in me, giving me a delight and desire to love him. So I'm going to put it in music. Kyle, we're ready for this song. I'm moving way ahead. Thank you.
to himself his own again. Silver Lamb, his only son, was freely offered, atonement for our sin forever made. He innocent and holy, still God and God only, could ransom and redeem us back again.
See, the person with a new mind is going to sing this kind of song.
I say hallelujah, praise the Lamb. Hallelujah, praise the Lamb. My heart sings his praise again. Hallelujah, praise the Lamb. Christian is ignorant in the hardening of their hearts and give themselves over to sensuality. So they're excited about everything but God. The Christian with the new mind says, hallelujah, praise the Lamb. I belong to him. I'm his. He's given me a new way of looking at everything.
Now, the details of that will be coming as we work later in Ephesians 4, but you catch the picture. It's not what we think about, it's how we think about everything. Heavenly Father, thank you that you've given us a new mind, that we're not futile in our thinking, we're not darkened in our understanding, we're not separated from the life of God. We're not hardened in our hearts. We're not given over to sensuality. All those things have been laid aside and we've been made entirely and totally new. And I pray today for those who know Christ that they would have a deeper appreciation for what you've done for us. And for those who aren't certain, that they'd say, Lord, I need a new mind. I need your new creation work to make me yours. Help us, Lord, to comprehend these things because the Holy Spirit is given to accomplish that very purpose. And I pray that as we leave this place today, we would have a deeper appreciation than we ever have of the work that you've done to make us new in Christ, and that we'd live like those new creation Christians so that people would look at us and say, wow, isn't God great? Pray, Lord, you dismiss us, and we thank you that we can trust ourselves into your care, and we do it in Jesus' name. Amen.